Thank you.
Hey, church. Pastor Dale here. It's good to be with you on this summer Sunday morning. Boy, it sure feels good to say those two words together. I hope you're well, and thank you for joining us for this time of worship today. Hey, if you're watching online through Facebook or through our webpage, we'd love to hear from you in the comment sections as you watch. Please let us know you're watching, who's with you. It helps us as we try to keep track of our viewing numbers. Glad that you're tuning in that way. You know, part of being church is marking sacred time. And of course, our walk with Christ is based on our story in the scriptures. And what we remember today is that 40 days after the resurrection of Christ from the dead, the crowds had gathered in Jerusalem for that feast of Pentecost. And that during that time, the Holy Spirit, God's Holy Spirit, blew through the crowd with a fiery wind, blowing inspiration and imagination and courage to be the church of Jesus moving forward. You know, I think about that story today on this Pentecost Sunday, and it reminds me that as we navigate our way through this time of waiting, how important it is to know that God's Spirit is still generously pouring over us to be the church in all the ways we can still today. So let's pray today for God's Spirit to fall on us and us to be open to that fresh anointing of Spirit. Hey, I want to thank all of you who helped us out in our process of understanding the best ways and safest ways to regather as a worshiping community. Thank you to those of you who participated in our online survey. A quick summary of those results tells us that over 60% of you are interested in returning to Church in the Park this summer. If the health and safety protocols are in place to keep us as safe as possible. It also showed that the majority of you who responded placed yourself in a risk category for COVID-19. So all to say that then speaks to how cautious we want to be in our planning as we move forward with this. Given our state's restrictions through mid-June, what it looks like at this point is we will have a delayed start to Church in the Park, but plans are being made right now for that so that we are ready to go when we're able to do that safely. I would also say that the results of the survey are posted online and you'll be able to look at those there. I also want to name that our Michigan Bishop, David Bard, has called for a special offering for those who are suffering from that massive flooding in the Great Lakes River region, river basin of our state. So I invite you to support our neighbors, both with prayers and through your gifts. And you can mail an envelope, mail your check into the church, just in the memo section note for flood relief. One last thing I want to mention, this week's online class, This Is My Now, features Kathy Steen. Kathy is one of our United Methodist clergy here in the Michigan area, and also Chaplain at Munson, and she's going to speak on the pandemic from her experience of working as a chaplain in a hospital situation. So you want to tune in and be a part of that. Lastly, I want to invite now Samantha Maldonado to come and bring us to worship.
Hello, it's Sunday. Are you awake and ready? For today, God might surprise you. Christ might show up in a way you weren't planning for. And Holy Spirit might even speak to you in the wind. We might not be together for now, but God is surely holding us all together and calling us wherever we are. This church, at our kitchen tables, in our cars, in the quiet of our bedroom. Are you awake and ready? Then let us worship and watch for the God who surprises.
We'd love to have you join us on our first song, This Is First. You'll find the lyrics up on the screen or in the songbooks in the back.
All the love we give, we've given first.
One more time.
All the love we give, you've given first.
Here we are. When we offer you our lives.
When we offer you our lives. Every sacrifice you've given first. You've given first. And when we make the choice to serve, attending others' needs, you served us first. You served us first. There is nothing we can do that you've not done for us. Father, you're the source of all that's love. And so we love to give because you gave so much. And now we live to love because you first loved us. And so we love to give because you gave so much. And now we live to love because you first loved us. You loved us first.
Here we are, when we walk.
Faithfulness, keeping covenant, you're faithful first. You're faithful first. And when we run to win the prize, to reach the finish line, you've run it first. You've won it first.
Here we are, every path
we suffer on. You have walked before. Every victory at one is yours.
And so we love to give because you gave so much. And now we live to love because you first loved us.
So we love to give because you gave so much.
So we love to give because you gave so much. And now we love to give because you first loved us.
And so we love to give because you gave so much. And now we live to love because you first loved us. You love us first.
Good morning, children. Pastor Dale here. It's good to be with you for a few moments this morning. I hope you had a great Memorial Day weekend, that you enjoyed your family. Hey, I'm wondering this morning if any of you have had a birthday since we've last met. Any birthdays out there? If so, I want to say happy birthday to you. And also let you know that one of our church members, Quint Stoltz, recently celebrated his 98th birthday. So think about that. If some of you are 8 years old, he's 90 years older than you. So happy birthday, Quint. God bless you. You know, we all have our birthdays, don't we? That day we took our first breath, that first breath of life when we came out of our moms. That's a special day to celebrate. It's a gift to us. But did you know that the church has a birthday too? That's right. The church has a birthday. And so today we say, happy birthday, church. This is what we call Pentecost Sunday. It's the birthday of the church. You see, as part of our story in our Bible, what we remember is long ago, Jesus's people, his family, his friends were all gathered together, and God blew a mighty wind through them and energized them with that wind to be the church and to share his love in the world. They were energized to be followers of Jesus. Now, you and I both know that it's hard to see the Spirit. God is invisible, and yet we see what God does. We see the good things that happen. And it reminds me a little bit about a fan. And I'm going to have a fan get turned on here. And there it goes. So you can see the ribbons blowing in the wind. I can feel the wind here. Maybe you can hear a little bit of it too. Wow, that feels good. It's getting warm in here. But I turned the fan on today to remind us that even though we can't see God, we can feel God, warmth, cool, love. And we can see the good things that God does in the world through God's people. And that includes you. God is giving you Holy Spirit to love others as children. So our message today is this: don't be shy. Don't be shy about being who you were born to be. You were created to be children of God, followers of Jesus, those with a mighty spirit in you to love boldly, to love your family and your neighbors and the world around you. I want you to know that as you grow up, God's Spirit is always with you, giving you everything you need. I hope you have a great Sunday. Enjoy your family. God bless. Hey, friends. As I mentioned earlier in the service, this is Pentecost Sunday. We celebrate God's giving of Holy Spirit to the church to be the community of Christ in the world today. And with that in mind, I want to offer our prayer of the people today. The opening of this prayer comes from the poet of the church, William Loder, and then some words as well as we pray for our situation and those who are dealing with the effects of this pandemic. So I invite you now into a time of prayer. O God, you are spirit, you are wind, you are breath. You meet us in the wonders of creation, in the awe of wonderful things, in the terror of fearful things. You blow among the greening leaves, even the broken branches, whining in pain, in the whirlwinds of delight. Your wind gently touches our brow with comfort and caress. Your forgiveness raises us to life. Your challenge disturbs our piles and spreads opportunities before our eyes. Gentle Spirit, breathe on us your life. Strong Spirit, open our closed doors to your compassion. Universal Spirit, inspire us to sing and sigh for justice. Spirit of Jesus, teach us to walk, to work, to pray, to live and love your way. Awaken our dreams, expand our visions, heal us for hope through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Oh God, in this time of waiting, as we, like those first disciples of Jesus, stay inside for fears of what's going on in the world, wondering what's next, we pray you'd pour your Holy Spirit on us, a spirit of courage and hope, that we might be those who live the way of Jesus before the world in all the ways we can. Give us, we pray, elders, families, youth, and children, the assurance of your presence and the power of your Spirit. We pray today as well for all those affected by the coronavirus, for all working to bring healing and hope, for all leaning into the common good. We pray your help. We pray your hope today. And now we join our voices in the prayer of our Lord and Savior Jesus, a prayer that unites us with Christians everywhere. We say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
It's a gospel story about the resurrected Jesus surprising people. May we hear it and be surprised as well. On the same day, two disciples were traveling to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking to each other about everything that had happened. While they were discussing these things, Jesus himself arrived and joined them on their journey. They were prevented from recognizing him. He said to them, "What are you talking about as you walk along?" They stopped, their faces downcast. The one named Cleopas replied, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who is unaware of the things that have been taking place here over the last few days?" He said to them, "What things?" They said to him, the things about Jesus of Nazareth. Because of his powerful deeds and words, he was recognized by God and all the people as a prophet. But our chief priests and our leaders handed him over to the sentence to death, and they crucified him. We had hoped he was the one who would redeem Israel. All these things happened 3 days ago. But there's more. Some women from our group have left us stunned. They went to the tomb early this morning and didn't find his body. They came to us saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who told them he is alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found things just as the woman said. They didn't see him. Then Jesus said to them, "You foolish people, your dull minds keep you from believing all that the prophets talked about. Wasn't it necessary for the Christ to suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then he interpreted for them the things written about himself in all the scriptures, starting with Moses and going through all the prophets. When they came to Emmaus, he acted as if he was going on ahead. But they urged him, saying, "Stay with us. It's nearly evening, and the day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. After he took his seat at the table with them, he took the bread, blessed, and broke it. He gave it to them. Their eyes were open and they recognized him, but he disappeared from their sight. They said to each other, "Weren't our hearts on fire when he spoke to us along the road and when he explained the scripture for us?" They got up, gathered together. They were saying to each other, "The Lord really has risen. He appeared to Simon." Then the two disciples were described what had happened along the road and how Jesus was made known to them as he broke the bread. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Samantha. I always enjoy it when you bring your Ecuadorian accent to the hearing of the gospel today. And how appropriate today, for this is Pentecost Sunday, friends, when we celebrate the Holy Spirit is a gift to God's people across the whole world in the church. Today is also a time we're celebrating graduation Sunday. So some of my comments today are really expressly to graduates, and we're going to do a little piece in a few minutes where we're honoring our graduates. So please stay with us. And no one has to tell you that the world has changed. But for the foreseeable future, it most certainly has. And as much as we like to flirt with the idea that can't we have a summer just like last summer, we know better. Today, I'm standing in this sacred place, which is our sanctuary. And you know, I got to thinking about its 100-year-plus history. And this is surely the longest time that these pews have remained empty, the pulpit over there being vacant, and the organ pipes having no moving air in them. And while our staff and our council are really busy at work right now, looking at what a regathering plan might be for our congregation, I have to tell you, I am missing all the life that happens in this room. How about you? The great singing of the congregation, the hugs, the postludes, the spirited faces on the choir, the cookie and conversations that happen after service, the laughter, the questions that children ask, the weddings, and yes, even the funerals, the horn section and the well band, and looking into your faces as we share the bread and cup of Holy Communion. I miss it all. And I mourn that it can't happen just yet. Well, if you're nodding your heads at any of what I just said, then you can surely relate to the two characters we have in today's gospel story. This guy named Cleopas and his companion, because their world was upended, their world was surely changed. Oh, we get it. We've heard some of the stories, haven't we, about how the world had changed for Jesus' disciples just after his crucifixion, scattering the lot of them. Despite rumors of resurrection and an empty tomb, everybody knew that they would not be returning to the good old days. But just listen to what all the gospel accounts say about how Jesus' admirers and his disciples, including these two we're looking at today, were in a state of mourning, which was right and proper for them to let themselves lament with their friends, just as it's right for us to mourn and lament change when it comes crashing into our world with little notice. With the coronavirus, we think about those who have suffered from the illness and perhaps have even passed away to the next world. We think about the loss of income and work for so many people during this pandemic. That's a crash. And the way communities of color have been especially hit, that's a terrible crash. But we also think on this graduation Sunday of how some of you grads had your ceremonies and your proms and your final semesters crashed. Claire Beitler from our congregation here, in fact, Claire is a daughter of our church. She graduated from MSU this spring. And I was talking to her and she told me how it really has grieved her heart to miss out on saying goodbye to friends and having some closure to her undergraduate life, despite all the good that she still knows is waiting for her in her future. Sisters and brothers, you have permission to grieve. So let me make that the first takeaway from today's gospel story about two friends walking that road to Emmaus. It's this: don't be afraid to mourn what is lost. Don't be afraid. Don't let anybody rob you of the importance of mourning and lament and grief for what is lost for now. It's psychologically healthy, and it's also spiritually healthy to mourn and let go before moving on. In fact, it's the folks who don't mourn who generally have the most trouble later on. There's a story told by the great preacher Otis Moss III, who's the pastor of a church in South Chicago. In fact, the same church that we, our eighth graders in confirmation class, go to every fall for one of our field trips. Reverend Moss, there in South Chicago, tells the story about a little boy who was speaking to his rabbi in a Jewish synagogue after worship service one Sunday. And the boy said to his rabbi, "Rabbi, why does God allow terrible things to happen to people and to allow things to fall apart?" Well, the rabbi thought about it for a few moments. And then he said to the boy, "Well, it's so we can fill in the cracks." Think about that. It is so we get to fill in the cracks. It is often that people will wake up spiritually following some misfortune by doing the work of searching for meaning and showing compassion and enlarging their empathy, all of which is part of filling the cracks of the broken places in this life. Next, I want you to notice in this gospel story how very important it is to have someone to lean on when your world falls apart. After Jesus dies in the gospel, we see how there's really several times that we hear the disciples are all huddled together in one place, in one room often. And it's really as much as anything because they seem to be in shock, but also to show support to each other, to be compassionate for that brother, that sister, as they figure out just what it is next that they're going to do in their life. I think about old Judas running off and hanging himself. And I wonder if even Judas could have found his redemption had he stayed in community with others. For when we are alone too much and our world falls apart then, that's when spiritual sickness and really emotional and mental illness can leave us hopeless and vulnerable. Friends, you and I are social creatures. Even what makes it make sense for me to speak into this camera lens is because in my mind, I'm imagining all of your faces engaging with me around the gospel. We are social creatures, and if you're a Christian, then you are surely part of a very social religion. We will always need companions and connectivity. Imagine some of us have felt that in an acute new way during the pandemic quarantine. Part of watching out for each other means picking up that phone or texting or having Zoom check-ins that bridge us to each other on a regular basis. In today's gospel story, our two friends on the road to Emmaus had one another to help find some meaning out of their world that had so abruptly changed. In fact, if you follow this story, it's precisely because these two are commiserating and talking so much on the road that the hidden disguised Jesus is able to hear them and come closer and enter into their conversation. So when the world changes, it's good to mourn your losses and to do that with people who love you. Which brings us to the third takeaway in today's story, I think. Jesus is with us even when we cannot see it. Jesus is with us even when we cannot see it. You remember how the two traveling somehow didn't recognize the resurrected Jesus walking there next to them, eavesdropping on their conversation? I love how the one named Cleopas, I guess he's had enough, because he turns and he spouts off to this pestering incognito Jesus. Are you the only visitor in Jerusalem who is unaware of the things that have taken place over the last few days? Notice how Luke, the writer of this story, really leaves a lot of mystery to this resurrection business by the way he tells it. But I'm thinking he does want the hearers and the readers to know how very much Jesus is with us when we cannot sense it. And it's because we choose to see so little in this life, really, to miss out on this enormous story of how God is continually and always at work redeeming the world. Why, our frame is too small. I brought an empty frame to kind of make my point here. You know, often all we can see is what is within our frame of reference when there's many realities outside this frame that we can learn from. And I think part of the work of this life is to ever be enlarging our frame. God is always present, even when we cannot sense the presence. And because God is present in you and you and you, because the Imago Dei is in each of us, that's part of the reason we take seriously this slow idea of regathering after this pandemic, so that we would not do anything to harm the divine image in each other. Which brings us to the fourth and the final little takeaway from this story today. So after these two companions have walked 7 miles from Jerusalem down to Emmaus, with Jesus listening in to some of their conversation. Now think about that, 7 miles. When is the last time that you hiked 7 miles? I remember doing a 7-mile hike in the Smokies a couple of years ago, and I was flat out beat at the end of the day. But these companions did that walk, and they come upon an inn on the road where they can get a meal and spend the night. And it looks as if Jesus is going to continue on. He's looking like, yeah, I'm just going to keep going on the road. But they reach out to him. Oh, no, no, please come and stay with us for the night here at this inn. The evening is coming on. We should have a meal together. Well, hey, I don't know about Jesus, but it looks like they're buying, okay? So he goes in with them. Notice what happens next. It says their eyes are open in the breaking of the bread. What an interesting line. Oh, we all know how things can be great between people when we sat down and shared a meal together. But this was even more than that. Jesus sat and broke the bread, just like he'd done a few days earlier when he shared that meal that we've come to call the Last Supper and Holy Communion with the disciples. And in this moment between the three of them, Christ shows up when a physical need is being met, hunger. Oh, sometimes, if we're awake to it, we catch the eye-opening spirit of Jesus being there in the room with us right when a physical need gets met for another person. It happens all the time. All the feeding that we do around here, feeding hungry people, Jesus is showing up in the middle of that all the time, and many of us on the edges see it. I'm even thinking about sharing a pizza in my backyard 2 weeks ago with social distance with a friend who was coming through town from downstate. And I realized in that moment how very much I had missed my friend as we shared pizza there. Christ's Spirit was showing up in our midst. So see what's happening with Jesus. Notice what happens. Their eyes are open in the breaking of the bread. Somehow he gets recognized in that moment. And when he gets recognized, mystery of mysteries, he disappears from their presence. Don't you think Cleopas and his friend must have turned to each other, looking dumbfounded and saying, did you see that? Tell me I'm not seeing things. Have we been imagining all this? Or was this the vision that we've been needing all along? Oh, weren't our hearts on fire when he walked with us and opened the scriptures to us, is what they say to each other. Well, when Jesus disappears just before dessert shows up, these two companions are kind of swept up. They're swept up into a new movement from their lament to now having a new hope. A turn has opened in the story for them. Their picture frame enlarges. And they take on this burst of energy, which is amazing to me. And they feel as soon as they finish their meal, before they rest for the night, they decide they're going to walk those whole 7 miles back to Jerusalem and tell their friends and companions, the entourage who followed Jesus, everyone, listen, the Lord has really risen. This is the road to Emmaus. It's a fascinating story, isn't it? It's meant for all graduates, all of us who are graduating from the world that we used to know into what is now a new world, or at least it seems so, but one that is very much brimming with hope, mind you. For we are all graduating from that world that once was, and praise be to God, there is the hidden Christ all around the edges of the frame in this new world. Wherever eyes are opened toward others and hearts are burning with a love not of our making. You know, years ago at a high school in southern Alabama was a graduation ceremony there in the stuffy auditorium of that little southern rural school. As every graduate crossed the stage, and upon receiving her high school diploma, one girl turned and faced the audience, raised her arms and shouted, "Educated by God." Everybody laughed and applauded. But upon retrospect, if she really believed what she shouted, it was more sad than humorous. If she thought that her education was complete, with a diploma from a rural high school in southern Alabama, she really was shortchanging herself, living inside a very small picture frame indeed. So graduates, I have this to say to you. Education needs to last our whole life long. It's never over. There is no excuse for being ignorant in today's world. There are too many ways that we get to continue to learn, to have our eyes continually opened, especially this year, with such important elections looming on the horizon. What we hear broadcast by the loudest voices is not nearly so important as learning what is true and not merely what's inflammatory. Oh, we are all entitled to our private opinions, but we are not entitled to our private set of facts. This is really what all graduations remind us of, to choose to live forward, eyes opened. I want to close by asking us all really to take a breath and reflect on an idea. Fred Rogers, who brought Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood to fame over so many years, he was asked to give the commencement address at Dartmouth College a few years back. He ended his address by saying to the crowd, "I'd like to give you an invisible gift, a gift of silence, to think about those who have helped you become who you are today." And the thousands who had gathered in that arena with Fred Rogers all stopped and thought about that. So I'd like you to consider the gift of these four lessons from the gospel today. Those lessons from the road, lessons that are like little specks of light to help us open our eyes as we graduate from high school or college or from this pandemic that's not yet over. Hear them again. Don't be afraid to lament. Stay connected with good companions. Remember, Jesus is with us even when we don't see it. And when we meet a physical need in another, it has the making of opening our eyes. Now, which of these lessons might you ask God to help you see a little more clearly these days? Where do you need to see this better on the road that you find yourself on? For apparently, Jesus loves to listen in and offer his two cents when asked for. Take a breath and be open. Now, I'd like you to join me in honoring the graduates who relate to our congregation. We have a little film video that will flash up their beautiful faces and what's going on in their life. And if you're tuned in by radio and can't benefit from seeing this, just look at the email that we send out Sunday morning, which also includes some notes from today's message. God bless you.
give me love, give me peace on earth, give me life, give me love, give me free from birth, keep me whole, help me cope with this heavy load, trying to touch and reach you with heart and soul. Help me cope with this heavy load, trying to touch and reach you with heart and soul. Heavy load, trying to touch and reach you with heart and soul. Give me love, give me peace on earth. Give me life, keep me free from birth. Give me hope, help me cope with this heavy load, trying to touch and reach you.
Friends, I want to take a moment and say thank you for your generosity to the church during these uncertain times. It's a tribute to, I think, your trust and your belief that God does provide for us, and so we can trust God and we can generously give, knowing that God will do good things through our giving to the ministry of Christ. So thank you for that. I want to leave you with this thought today, these words of benediction. Thinking about Pastor Chris's message, it reminds me that when we least expect it, when the future seems uncertain and we're about to give up all hope, the Spirit of the risen Christ comes our way to show us the way. My friends, you can count on that. Seek it. Step toward it with the expectation that God's grace is going to come to you and that God's grace and mercy will flow through you and do good works through your life in the power of the Pentecost Spirit. May the peace of Christ, the love of God, and the encouragement of the Holy Spirit go with you, and indeed, it does. Amen.